Test.
Good morning and welcome. This is your Burlington Chamber of Commerce's federal candidates, and we've been deliberating what to call it. It was called a meeting. Some said it should be a discussion. It's definitely not a debate, so it will be more of a discussion in context. My name is Bruce Nicholson. I'm your current chair of the board of your chamber, and I have the pleasure of acting as your moderator today. We have brought together candidates for the position of MP for Burlington to address you and to answer your questions about issues that matter most to you and your business. This discussion, as you can probably guess, is being recorded by TV Kojiko, and it will air on the dates of October 4th at 8 p.m., October 5th at 7 p.m., and 2 p.m. on October 8th. This morning's meeting is sponsored by the Realtors Association of Hamilton Burlington, and I would like to thank RAHB, their acronym, for their generous support that allows our chamber to provide this opportunity to communicate directly with your federal candidates. At this time, I would like to recognize the VIPs in the audience. And they include our beloved Mayor Rick Goldring, Paul Sharman from Ward 5 at the back, we also have past chairs of the board of your Burlington Chamber, and they include, in no particular order, alphabetical maybe, Rick Burgess, John Doyle, Jamie Edwards, and last but not least, Tamara Fanny. Also considered VIPs today, we have Chris and Lindsay and a table from the civics class of Blythe Academy in Burlington. Our future political leaders. I encourage you to connect on social media before, during, and after this discussion. You will find a social media card in the middle of your tables with the information. And before I invite George O'Neill from RAHB to the podium to introduce our federal candidates, I would like to review the format for this morning's discussion. I have to read this. This is not from memory. Each candidate will be given 90 seconds for opening remarks, and they will go in order of a random draw. We will take questions from the floor. Please write your questions on the paper provided on your tables. They will be collected by chamber staff, and I will read the question. Please specify if your question is for an individual candidate or all candidates. If your question is for a specific candidate, others at the front will be provided the opportunity to respond following the initial responder. Please make sure your question is not too long, and for my benefit, please write legibly or print. We reserve the right to edit questions for length and content to make sure there are no inflammatory comments or, in most cases, duplications of questions, as there will be common questions and topics that you wish addressed. We would ask candidates to limit your responses to 60 seconds. A yellow card will indicate 10 seconds remaining, and a red card indicates time is up. And that's when I jump in. To determine the order of candidates in answering of the questions, we've gone to the scientific approach of alphabetical order. And for subsequent questions, we will rotate the order, but always alphabetically. Each candidate will have 90 seconds for closing remarks following the last question. And that'll be either 9:20 or earlier. 9:20 is our targeted conclusion. And all candidates, just so you know, all of our candidates have been provided with these guidelines ahead of time. Our official timer today, and you met him earlier, is Tamer Fahmy, seated here at the front. And I asked him how comfortable he was, and he said, I'm very comfortable with the colored cards. I'm a soccer referee on weekends. So we look forward to that. And I would now ask George O'Neill from the Real Estate Board to introduce our front podium.
Great, thank you. So good morning, everyone, and thank you so much for coming out this morning. The Realtors Association of Hamilton Burlington, or we call it for short RAB, is proud to partner with the Burlington Chamber to host this event. It's an important way for us to bring the candidates to the... has over 35 years of experience in electronics and information technology. He currently teaches cloud administration under contract for some of the world's largest IT companies. Soon after he moved to Burlington in 2010, Vince founded the Friends of Sheldon Creek Watershed Volunteer Stewardship Community Organization, and he received the Conservation Halton Watershed Stewardship Award for this work. He's an active volunteer in the Burlington community and with many organizations. Karina Gould grew up in Burlington and is an active member of the community. She attended high school at M.M. Robinson, obtained a joint honors degree in political science and Latin American studies, and recently completed her master's in international relations. Before pursuing her candidacy full-time, Karina worked as a trade and investment specialist in Toronto. David Laird has a proven track record of fighting for the less fortunate in our community. David currently works for the Children's Aid Society of Toronto, and he is also vice president of CUPE Local 2316, North America's largest child protection local union. David has been increasingly active in the Burlington community, promoting positive solutions on complex issues such as clean energy, affordable childcare, social equality, and human rights. Mike Wallace has served as the Member of Parliament for Burlington since 2006, a graduate of the University of Guelph, who majored in economics and political science. He served as a council member in Burlington from 1994 until gaining the federal seat. In Ottawa, he chairs the Standing Committee on Justice and Human Rights. He also chaired the Conservation Marine Caucus, is part of the Interparty Steel Caucus, and co-chairs the Canadian-Japan Parliamentary Association. He has a reputation for hard work, straight talk, and dedication.
Thank you, George. I actually had a photo op earlier with the candidates, and I didn't say anything to them, but I was surprised at how refreshed they look for such a long campaign process and this early in the morning. So, congratulations. Thank you. Candidates, you will now have 90 seconds for opening remarks. As I mentioned earlier, we will go in a random order, which was done prior to this event. We will start with David Laird.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for attending, and thank you to the Burlington Chamber of Commerce for hosting this event. I'm proud to say that this is my fifth election in my 10-year quest to job interview to be your next MP. And I want to personally thank Stephen Harper and Mike Wallace for demonstrating what I've been saying for over 10 years, that the policies of the Conservative Party don't work for the majority of Canadians, nor do they work to create a clean environment and a robust economy for Canadians. I look forward to presenting to you a comprehensive plan of the new Democratic Party to invest in infrastructure, transit, seniors, social housing, address poverty, address student issues and student debt. And overall, I think the plan that we are presenting is a plan consistent with the plans of other countries that have had increased economic performance over the last economic downturn, in complete contrast to our stagnating economy and the worst performance of any prime minister in the last 50 years. Canadians are ready for change, and I think, from what I'm hearing at the door and hearing on the news, that 70% of Canadians want change. I think in some ways that this is going to be a referendum on our electoral system and whether it works for the vast majority of Canadians. We have a plan through multi-member proportional representation to address that critical role in our democracy. And again, thank you, and I look forward to taking your questions.
I now call upon Vince Fiorito.
Hello everyone, I'm Vince Fiorito. I'm the Green Party candidate for Burlington. I'm kind of new to the political process. I didn't know I was going to be the candidate until about 3 weeks ago. It was like a surprise, because my environmental activism, the APTA, if I wanted to be the Green Party candidate. So I'll introduce myself. I'm 53 years old. I come from an ethnically diverse and tolerant background. My wife is from Bolivia. My family is people from Barbados, China. Basically, when we get together at holidays, it's like the UN convention. Okay, so my grandfather and my father both died in the early 60s of heart attacks, and I'm 53 years old, so it doesn't look good for me, so I'm planning on living my life like I got 10 years left to live. Okay, so I subscribe to an international growing movement called Rights of Nature, where basically, the idea is basically if we take care of nature, nature will take care of us. And I've been following this philosophy for probably most of my life. Okay, so as you heard, I founded the Friends of Shelton Creek Watershed, and I've been taking pictures of the trash that's in our ravines, and you would not believe what I have found in Burlington, including a toxic waste dump in one of the neighborhoods here. If you want to read more about it, you can read it on my Facebook page. I'm on Facebook. My nonpartisan is Shelton Creek, and my partisan political is Vince Fiorito. I'm an independent. No, I'm going to go down to that. Yeah, independent technical trainer, opinionated, okay, but polite, native plant society. I accepted the Green Party nomination because my personal viewpoints closely agree with what the Green Party policy is.
I now call upon Mike Wallace.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you, Bruce. And I want to thank the Chamber for hosting this event this morning, this discussion. I think it's important for all of us to get an opportunity to see our candidates in answering a few questions, and I appreciate that CoachCo is here today to be able to broadcast this to those who could not make it this morning. As in my introduction, I have been the Member of Parliament here for almost a decade, and prior to that, very active in the community as a City Councillor. So I'm in my 22nd year of elected office, and honored to be the Member of Parliament and to be a representative of this community. In the community, I've been very active individually. I attend about 160, a little more than 160 events a year. I meet with constituents on a regular basis, whether it's a group or individuals dealing with their individual problems. We have an excellent staff at the Burlington Mall office. Over 170 people a year we meet with. I've been a bit of a dog with a bone in Ottawa, talking about different projects that are required or needed or wanted by Burlington. I've been able to indirectly or directly deliver over $250 million since taking office in 2006 to Burlington for a number of projects, and I have a list of those projects with me if anybody wants to see them. I'm very active in this community. I think the government of Canada is doing the right thing in the right direction economically, and that's why I think and I hope that you support me and the Conservative government on October 19th. Thank you very much.
Karina Gould.
I was guessing I was going to be last.
Good guess.
Thank you very much, Bruce, and to the Chamber of Commerce for having us here this morning. As was mentioned, I'm Karina Gould. I'm your Liberal candidate here in Burlington. I'm running because for too long, we've heard Ottawa's voice in Burlington and not Burlington's voice in Ottawa. I was raised in Burlington, and I'm proud that we live in a successful community. But we know that better is always possible. As leaders in this community, you understand that we must base decisions on evidence, address climate change, as this chamber has called for, get the people and goods where they need to be, when they need to get there, create good jobs, affordable housing, and accessible childcare, and provide a dignified retirement for our seniors. And most importantly, you understand the way to grow your organization is by forming strong partnerships. A Liberal government will strengthen Canada. We will invest in infrastructure, deliver a national climate change strategy, create jobs and grow the middle class, and make Canada both a partner here at home and abroad. On October 19th, we will have to decide, what kind of future do we want for Canada? You can choose a government that will make smart investments in Canada's future, grow the economy, and ensure fair, equal opportunities for all Canadians. I'm ready to bring real change to Canada and to be a strong voice for Burlington. Thank you. I'm looking forward to this discussion.
Thank you, Karina. Thank you, all candidates. We will now move to the question and answer segment. As mentioned earlier, there are sheets of paper to record your questions on. We have, and I want to thank our audience, we have been provided with a number of questions already. A chamber staff member will circulate the room and pick up your questions from your table. I'd also like to thank at this time our Political Action Committee of our chamber for organizing this event. And I think it's a very important event for the city of Burlington. So I want to remind candidates, you have 60 seconds for your response. And I don't want it to appear rude, but at the red mark, I'll probably just say thank you. So just to keep it flowing, we have quite a few questions. And perception is everything, so we'll make sure everyone is treated the same. As I mentioned earlier, it will be alphabetical order, but rotating alphabetical order. So the first question, and this was provided, we'll kick the ball, get the ball rolling with our Political Action Committee's question. Given that the city of Burlington has a higher than average seniors population, we are concerned about healthcare. While this is a provincial matter, the province relies on funds received from the federal government through the Canada Health Transfer. Could you provide an overview of your party's policy concerning the Canada Health Transfer? And we'll start with Vince.
Hi there. The Green Party has a national senior strategy. Basically, it is affordable housing for seniors, guaranteed living income. What that means is that everybody has the right to live at least a minimalist lifestyle with dignity. Okay, we introduced the PharmaCare program before it was adopted by the NDP. So that's what you'll find that often a lot of Green Party ideas have been borrowed by other parties. We have a national dementia strategy, including long-term care facility in our neighborhoods, pension plan, expansion of the Canada Pension Plan, an approach that supports aging in place. Intergenerational daycare. I think it's a good idea that actually we combine elderly daycare with child daycare, where the older people can expand their experience to the young people who are growing. I think that there's mutual benefits if we can do that, and also trying to keep people in their homes where it's less expensive and more comfortable.
Thank you, Vince. Karina?
Thank you very much for that question, and in fact it gives me the opportunity to mention that I've actually been knocking on doors for a year in Burlington, and my team and I have reached out to over 50,000 people so far, and the number one issue that I hear at the door is healthcare. So I'm really glad this was raised because it is the top concern for people in Burlington. And one thing that is extraordinarily important is that while in essence it is a provincial responsibility, we have something called the Canada Health Act, which makes it a federal responsibility as well. And it is important that we have demonstrated federal leadership on healthcare to ensure that all Canadians get access to the quality care that they require. I'm very proud to announce that Mr. Trudeau announced our healthcare strategy this week. We're talking about an additional $3 billion for home care, which is directly related to the issue of our aging population, which just yesterday was mentioned is going to double in the coming years. And talk about a national drug buying program, which was actually presented under 2006 under Paul Martin, and to talk about a mental health care strategy
thank,
as well.
Thank you, Karina. David?
Thank you.
The NDP is committed to seniors. With the party that brought you national health care, we're introducing a national pharmacare program. This will certainly help many seniors who spend a large proportion of their income on medicine. It'll also give about $3 billion worth of savings to the provinces that they can use in other areas. The NDP is committed to a seniors program to boost long-term care facilities, support seniors in palliative care, and also provide incomes in the guaranteed income supplement for seniors. There's a range of initiatives as well that support seniors in terms of housing programs and other social programs across the country. Singularly, senior care is the most important issue that we've seen on the doorstep as well. And the NDP is committed to supporting seniors in their retirement.
Thank you, David. Mike.
Thank you, Bruce. And I believe the question was about the health transfer. So, since we took office in 2006, the health care transfer was at $19 billion. As of last year, it'll be $30 billion. There was a 6% annual increase that had been negotiated starting in 2004, was to end in 2014. The finance minister of the Conservative government, Mr. Fiorito, extended that by 3 years, so the 6% accelerator continued on to 3 years. In 2017-18, it goes to 3% plus growth. So the amount of money that is being transferred to the provinces for healthcare continues to increase at an accelerated rate, goes to 3% in 2017-18, plus the opportunity for growth. So that with a province that is having growing population, they can apply for more funding up to 4 or 5%, and then it's up to the province to decide which community is allocated those funds. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. Way to go, candidates. That was a good way to, we've
right?
got a few.
Okay. Thanks for coming.
It's gonna be, we're on a roll, this is excellent. Question number two. This is from our audience. When will we tackle our debt and stop putting our spending on the shoulders of future generations? And we'll start with Karina.
Thank you. This is an excellent question to have, and I would like to point out that the Conservative government has added $250 billion worth of debt since they took office. One of the things that we're seeing right now is a stagnation of our economy, and when we're talking about how we are going to grow our economy and how we're going to get ourselves out of debt, you can't save your way to prosperity. Just like people who, and just like businesses, when you are trying to grow and expand your business, you need to invest a little bit in order to grow and to expand, which is exactly what the Liberal government would do should we be elected on October 19th, is we would do the biggest infrastructure spend in Canadian history of $125 billion so that we can get public infrastructure ready, we can do social infrastructure, sustainable infrastructure, so that we can begin to create jobs, spur manufacturing, and create growth that will help us get out of this stagnant economy, onto a good track, and get down to paying that debt. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. David.
Well, the NDP, as you know, is presenting a balanced budget with actually projected surplus of about $2.7 billion with contingency funding. I just want to add on the previous question also, we're restored $36 billion in projected cuts that the Conservatives have made. But on infrastructure spending, and keeping a balanced budget. The NDP is committed to address the stagnant economy by taxing corporations, raising the percentage from 15% to 17%, still on average lower than during Stephen Harper's tenure, and using this money in investments in infrastructure, transit, and developing a manufacturing sector economy based on clean energy and renewable energy, and transitioning off fossil fuels. We'll end subsidies to the oil industry and make those investments back in our communities and our industries. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Mike?
Thank you, Bruce, and I thank you for the question. And that is a issue that we've tackled as a government. When we first took office, we made significant impact on paying down debt. Unfortunately, we ran into the worldwide recession that we had. We had to do deficit financing to stimulate our economy, and we did the best of the G7 countries in terms of coming out of that recession. There is no doubt that we were not happy about doing deficit financing, but there's something that we had to do. Our goal is, now that we're back into surplus, continue those surpluses, and the surpluses, a major percentage of that surplus should go to debt. We need to be paying down that debt that we've accumulated, so we do not pass those costs onto our younger folks, the future generations. So debt is an important cornerstone. Debt repayment is an important cornerstone of our policy going forward in a surplus situation that we have in this country and for many years to come, hopefully.
Thank you, Mike. Vince.
Hi. I've never believed in spending money that we don't have. If you follow my campaign, you'll see that I'm pretty low budget. I don't have $240,000 like my competitors here, so very low stream. I don't think that we should leave. Debt. I think the debt is a problem we're leaving for future generations, along with climate change and the biodiversity crisis. So I don't think that we should be burdening future generations with that. So I believe that we should be trying to find new streams of revenue. The Green Party supports a carbon-based tax. We do believe in increasing corporate income tax, so I don't believe that we should be involved in a race to the bottom. We should actually raise our corporate taxes. Corporations currently have over $600 billion in what we call dead money, basically money sitting in the banks. Obviously, we're not taxing them enough if they can afford to have that much money sitting around not creating jobs. Okay, so instead of part, yes. So I believe that, okay, that's good enough for me.
Thank you, Vince. Okay, question number three. And actually, this is a question that is addressed directly to a candidate. So again, the candidate will be provided the opportunity, and it just happens that we've put it in the order as it's directed to David, and then the others will be able to respond. Mr. Laird, would your party consider forming a coalition government or support a minority Liberal government if there is no clear winner in the general election?
Well, I think we've demonstrated in the past that we're committed to bringing effective change that meets the needs of Canadians. I know we've, in the past, worked with other party leaders to implement policies that are a benefit to Canadians, like the Canada Health Care Act. We did that working through a minority government. And Tom Mulcair has been clear that he will work with the Liberals in the case of a minority government, but he will absolutely not work with Stephen Harper in the event that Stephen Harper tries to form the government and comes to us for a request. There's no way that will happen. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Sorry, I was just dodging the photographer. Mike.
Thank you, Bruce. I think the solution to the problem is to vote a conservative majority government. Thank you.
Did you mean me? Thank you, Mike. Actually, we might get through these questions. Vince.
Cooperation has always been Green Party policy. We've always been willing to work with other political organizations and cooperate where we agree and work against each other where we disagree. Areas where we agree with other political parties include the PharmaCare plan, which the NDP has implemented, so of course we're going to support them on that. Reducing medical expenses, reducing childcare expenses, taking care of the elderly, dealing with problems related to poverty. So of course we're going to work with the other parties. We're a cooperative group. Best outcome for us is that we could be holding the balance of power in the next election, a minority government, in which case we would be able to really implement a lot of our policies because they're going to have to play with us, okay, rather than ignore us. And we know that the Green Party has been ignored. They're not invited to all the candidates' debates. We feel that we have a voice that should be heard, and we feel that we're not being heard as much as we should, so give me a chance to be heard.
Thank you, Vince. Karina.
Thank you. We have made it very clear that we would not support a minority conservative government. We would work with other parties to ensure that what happens is in the best interest of Canadians. I think it is very important to understand why we would not be supporting a conservative government, and that is because that, in terms of the economic record, this has been the worst economic record since R.B. Bennett. We're also talking about the anti-democratic policies that have been put into place, the omnibus bills that are 400 pages in length that people don't know what they're voting for, and there are certain things that I really do encourage people to look into more closely, and the attack on evidence and logical decision making that has become, previously was a cornerstone of Canadian development and has disappeared, and we would not support a conservative government moving forward.
Thank you, Karina. Question number 4. What are your views on Canada's minimum wage? And what should it be, and who should receive it? Mike?
Sure, Canada does not have a minimum wage. The minimum wage is set by the provinces. At one time in Canada's past, there was a national minimum wage for employees of federal government, in a sense. But that policy issue has been left to the provinces to decide based on the economic conditions and the that the provinces are facing. We as a party are not proposing and do not intend to propose a national minimum wage. That is, in our view, the responsibility of the provinces, and we're going to leave it with them.
Thank you, Mike. Vince.
Green Party policy is a guaranteed living income. People should be able to live with dignity, live in their houses, but the cost of living is different in different communities. So setting it at $15 is rather arbitrary. It may cost more than that for a person to live with dignity in Toronto than $15 an hour. It may cost less than that elsewhere. So the idea is basically that whatever it costs for people to live with dignity, that's what they should be, that's what kind of income that they should have where they're living. And it should be guaranteed for everybody. We believe that equal pay for equal work, women's rights, affordable child care, incentives for daycare at work, tax hikes for those that don't provide daycare at work. So it encourages employers to be good employers. We believe that everybody deserves a living wage wherever they are. And if they're not getting a living wage, then we believe that, my personal opinion on that anyway, the Green Party policy is that those companies should be punished. Companies that do provide living wages, then they should be getting tax benefits and better advantages in taxes. Thank you.
Thank you, Vince. Karina?
Great, thank you. This is my personal opinion because, as Mike mentioned, there is not a federal minimum wage. However, I don't believe that should encumber us from having a federal minimum wage because there are federally regulated industries that fall without and outside of the jurisdiction of provincial minimum wages. And so there is no reason why, at the federal level, we cannot say what a decent minimum wage would be for those federally regulated industries while still respecting provincial jurisdiction and the minimum wages that have been set there. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. And David.
So it's been clear, NDP policy, that we're setting a $15 minimum wage for federal employees across Canada. This will set the standard for industry and other businesses throughout the country. $15 isn't enough. It's not enough to live on. Everybody knows that. You need at least $17 to $20 an hour, but $15 an hour is a good start. And we have to be clear here that over the last, since 2000, since the Liberals and Conservatives, between two of them, started all these massive tax cuts, as Vince referred to, our corporate sector's piled up $700 billion in debt money, And consumers during that same time have piled up $660 billion in debt. That doesn't include debts incurred by provincial, federal governments and municipal governments. There's been a clear wealth transfer over the last 15 years, and we have to start by reversing that. Some of our tax policies will help to address that and get that money back into the economy and moving. But certainly, as a start, we need to set a standard for all workers across the country, and $15 minimum wage is a way to do that.
Thank you, David. We'll return to a question of our Political Action Committee. Does your party have a national housing strategy that would assist Burlington in building affordable housing? We'll start this one with Vince.
Well, the solution to homelessness is build more homes. Seems pretty simple to me. Do we have a national housing strategy? Yes, we do. We believe that affordable housing is a right that everybody should have access to, no matter how much money you have. All right, so part of the problem is that when developers develop, they tend to focus on luxury homes because that's where there's more money to be made. And they don't focus enough on affordable housing. So it makes sense to me that luxury homes are too lucrative for the developers. So my personal opinion is that if you want to do luxury developments, then you should have to pay for that because they're obviously growing that area. At the same time, then it allows affordable housing to be subsidized. And when a developer wants to do a development, it should include either including affordable housing in the development or paying into a fund that will help provide affordable housing somewhere in the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Vince. Karina.
Thank you for this really, really timely question. As many of you know, we have 4,000 people on the wait list for affordable housing in Halton. 80% of them are seniors. And I have spoken with so many people in this community who are, in many respects, house rich but income poor. And there's more people that also need housing beyond them. But we have a shortage of affordable rental housing in Canada. We have a shortage of available affordable housing, and the Liberal Party absolutely has a national housing strategy. We've committed to $20 billion in social infrastructure, which includes building new affordable housing units. It includes seniors accommodations and assisted living that would be directly transferred to the municipalities, because we understand, as the Federation of Canadian Municipalities has called for, that municipalities know the needs of their communities and they are best able to implement those. And finally, we also understand that we need to incentivize developers to build rental housing, and we will eliminate the GST for those developers.
Thanks. Thank you, Karina. David.
Thank you. Yes, the NDP has committed to reinstituting the National Housing Strategy. As you know, the National Housing Strategy was cut in the 90s by the Paul Martin government to help fund this massive wealth transfer I referred to. And when the Conservatives came in, they started with a 40-year, 5% down mortgage incentives that they later retracted. But that, in turn, helped to instigate a housing bubble in Canada that we're still trying to recover from managed down. It's you know, this policy was instituted from the United States. But no, the NDP is committed to work with municipalities and provinces to create 10,000 new rental housing units. We have a program to work on cooperative housing, and we're also going to work with industry leaders and developers to create peer-to-rent rental buildings as well. So we will continue with national housing strategy as part of our comprehensive plan to address deficits created in our economy by the last two governments of Liberals and Conservatives. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Mike.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you for the question. One of the things that I'm most proud of and what we've done over the last number of years, housing is actually a provincial responsibility, but we have come to the table with the Canada Ontario Affordable Housing Program. And in this riding alone, we have Bonnie's Place, which we put $5.38 million towards. We also have the seniors housing that has been developed along Plains Road, where the new library branches in the lower level. And so it's a mixed use facility that was a partnership with the region. I think the program of Canada and Ontario, Canada and other provinces, working on providing affordable housing, and in this community, particularly for seniors, it is the number one issue that I hear in my office about from seniors, is the availability of housing. We have done two projects here locally. I think there could be more to be done, but I think through that program of partnership with the region, with the provinces, and with the federal government, that's the best way to deliver that program.
Thank you, Mike. Question number six. What are your views on Canada's sex trade laws? Karina.
Thank you for that question. One of the issues, and there was a recent bill that was passed by this Conservative government, that the Supreme Court of Canada had asked to review the sex worker and sex trade laws in Canada because they did not create a safe environment for sex workers. The Conservatives passed a bill which would actually make it illegal. It wasn't illegal before, and would actually make it more dangerous and more difficult for sex workers to continue on with their lives. We are very committed to ensuring that vulnerable people are safe, that vulnerable people are treated fairly and respected, and that is something that this government has not done because their legislation is actually anti-constitutional, and the Supreme Court has said that this is unacceptable, and we would work with the Supreme Court and with stakeholder groups to ensure that we are putting in effective legislation.
Thank you, Karina. David?
Thank you. Yes, I have to concur with Karina there in terms of conservative actions in this area. They've victimized the victims and protected the perpetrators on this one. To be honest, I can't recall any specific policy on NDP from the NDP with relation to sex trade workers, but I do want to say that on a similar note, the NDP is committed to opening a commission to investigate the missing and murdered Aboriginal woman in Western Canada. There's a lot of concern. I'm sure you've read a lot of reports in this area that this issue is much larger than the Conservative government is really giving information on. And it appears that there seems to be some kind of, I mean, the murdered and missing women on industrial scale, and this needs to be addressed. And I think that that's a good place to start right now.
Thank you, David. Mike.
Thank you for that question. As chair of the Justice Committee who oversaw that legislation that was being referred to, I'd like to clarify a few things. First of all, we did not make prostitution illegal in the new law. It is what actually we did is those who are purchasing sex is now, that is the crime. It's the Swedish model that they use in Sweden. We adopted much of that, but made it applicable to the Canadian environment. So the purchase of sex is now illegal. I challenge anybody in the room who's interested in this topic to read the testimony that happened at committee. 99% of the women who are involved, men or women who are involved in this trade, are not there willingly. It's human trafficking, it's related to drugs and gangs. I challenge you that is the, what we're doing is making sure that those who are causing this terrible instance of sex trade, that we make them the criminals,
Thank you, Mike.
The women. Thank you.
It's corporate and international, Mike, and not addressing
issues. Okay, it's not a debate. Not a debate.
Just important to have clarification.
Yeah, okay.
Well, that's why I did it.
Okay. Now look, I'm supposed to take control here. Okay, question number seven. Vince, I got excited here.
I couldn't disagree with Mike Wallace more strongly. I agree with Pierre Trudeau. There's no place for the state in bedrooms of the nation. As soon as I've heard adults consenting to sex, I've heard enough. I don't need to know why their motivation is for sex. And a lot of the problems that we have in the sex trade industry are because it's illegal and it drives it underground. That's why we have these problems. So the Green Party policy is legalize, regulate, tax. Okay, and also sin taxes to fund programs that counsel sex trade workers before, during, and after they enter the sex trade. We want to make it a small business that's run, corporations that stay out of it. But we also disagree with advertising. Parents should be able to control what their children know. And people don't want to see and hear or know anything about the sex trade shouldn't have to deal with it, should be shoved in their faces. Benefits of a legalized system include increasing cooperation between sex traffickers, workers, and the criminal justice system, tax revenue, safer health and working conditions for sex trade workers, increased tax revenue, reducing crime, reducing poverty.
Thank you, Vince. Moving on to question number 7. If your government generates a budget surplus, what will they do with it? And we'll start off with David.
Thank you for the question. What an idea, budget surplus. Beautiful. It'd be nice to see, after so many years of mismanagement, the worst performance of any prime minister in the last 50 years. We would commit to bolstering our contingency reserve fund. Given the fluctuations in economic activity globally and nationally, it's our position that the federal government has not effectively made contingency funding a priority. Also, with the remaining funds, we would look at paying down debt. But I just want to emphasize that, you know, with all the talk about debt and deficit, we're in relatively good shape in this country in relation to our debt to GDP ratio. I think the important thing that we need right now is investments in the community, in industry, in children, families, and students to kickstart our economy and to create greater revenues into the future.
Thank you, David. Mike?
Thank you, Bruce. There will be a combination of things that the Conservative government will do. Debt repayment will be part of it. We do have a regulation, a guideline that based on the volume or the amount of the surplus, a certain percentage needs to go to debt repayment right off the top. Then the balance of that would be spent on priority items, priority areas, including job creation activities. If you look at our platform, we're not spending millions and billions of dollars that we don't have, or we won't, and we're not planning on going into further deficit and debt to spend on projects that aren't actually needed, that will be able to drive the economy. We need the private sector to take up the cause, to make sure that they are the job creators, to continue that process. We need incremental spending to support the job creators and then pay down debt.
Thank you, Mike. Vince?
So the Green Party believes in paying down the national deficit if we have a surplus, but also that's going to give us the flexibility to be able to afford the future costs in healthcare. Our demographic is changing. We're looking at some very expensive problems coming our way in the future. Canada pension plan is underfunded, so we want to basically be able to plan for that. So by paying down the debt now is going to help us be able to absorb increased costs in the future. We'd also like to point out that technology changes, and there are some major technology changes coming our way. The Stone Age didn't end because we ran out of stones. Okay, and the fossil fuel age is not going to end because we ran out of fossil fuels. So we also believe in funding research and development for the new technologies that are coming our way and creating the conditions for wealth generation. We don't believe that the government should be actually creating jobs directly, but actually creating the conditions for entrepreneurs and businesses to be able to create jobs. Thank you.
Thank you, Vince. Karina?
Thank you. I just want to have a brief moment about surplus, because the current government is saying they have a $1.5 billion surplus, and as Mr. Wallace pointed out, they don't spend money they don't have, but they don't spend money that they do have either. So they only have this surplus because they left almost $10 billion unspent last year. That's $1 billion that didn't go to veterans. That's $1 billion that didn't go to Aboriginals. That's billions of dollars that didn't go towards infrastructure. So I think it's important to understand what we're talking about when we're talking about surplus, and to realize that to get there, you don't spend your emergency money and you don't sell $1 billion worth of GM shares to get there. So I think we do want to be into surplus. We want to get back into surplus. But when we're talking about surplus, how do we get there? What are we spending money on? What are the services and the products that we're providing to Canadians to ensure that we are functioning as a government should be? And when we get back into surplus, it's about paying down that debt. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. Moving on to question number 8. Currently, for many skilled trades, each province has its own set of regulations. This means that workers who are licensed in one province cannot work in another. How would your party work with the provinces to make it easier for Canadians in regulated trades to move where the work is within Canada? We'll start this with Mike.
I agree that that is a problem that we've been, something that individuals in my own, in this riding have come to see me about, that they have a skill set, a training program that is acceptable in Ontario, but they can't work in Quebec or they can't work in other communities. We do have Red Seal trade certification, which Red Seals trade, my understanding is you should be able to take that trade and go across the country with it. I think that we should be working with the provinces and trying to make sure that the regulations can match you completely so that you are able to transfer your skill set, move to whatever province you want, and to work. I think part of the issue that we need to face in this country is the mobility of labor. People should be able to go where the work is and succeed. And part of that problem that we're having is these provincial regulations that are different in each province. And I think, I'll be frankly, I think the federal government has a role in facilitating regulations.
Thank you. Vince.
The Green Party believes in establishing educational standards right across the country. You should be able to move from one province to the other, and your skills and education should be transferable. We also believe that the skilled trades and that should also fall in the same category. If you're an electrician in one province, you should be able to meet a common standard right across the country. You should be able to work as an electrician in the other province after you've had the training for the unique situation in that province. But basically, if you're an electrician in one place, you basically know how to be an electrician in another place. You may have to come up to speed on the local or the provincial building codes and so on. We believe that there's so we believe that basically people should be able to travel from one place to the other, and in fact encouraging people to go from where work is scarce to where work is where there's a shortage of skilled workers. Should be easy transition.
Thank you, Vince. Karina.
Thank you. I'm going to throw out a really novel concept and something that I heard about growing up in the history books. It's called a First Minister's Meeting. And it means that the Prime Minister gets together with the Premiers and they talk about issues of national importance. And where there are issues that are of provincial jurisdiction, they can come together and talk as a country. This is something we haven't seen for about 10 years under the Conservative government, and it reflects the Liberal notion and the Liberal Party's plan to work in partnership with other levels of government to address national issues. And this is something that if the Prime Minister that we had would meet with his or her counterparts, then we could work towards eliminating these barriers to labor mobility as in a country. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. Moving over to David.
You're welcome. Yeah, over the last 10 years, we've seen a prime minister singularly focused on international trade, and still at the same time, we've had only a 0.3% increase in trade and the largest trade deficit in Canadian history. But you're right, absolutely correct, that the NDP's focus is on building the economy from within. But as Karina outlined, the restrictions across Canada have more trade barriers than our international trade partnerships. Tom Mulcair, like Justin Trudeau, is committed to getting back to the old style Canada where our Prime Minister actually sits down with the premiers of this country and discusses issues of mutual interest to address those in a clear and pragmatic way and to prioritize those issues in such a way that address the economic foundations of our country. So thank you for that question. It's a really good one.
Thank you, David. We're now moving into question number 9. How will your party increase manufacturing in Canada? Vince?
We're in the age of robots. It's robotic phone calls, robotics monitoring technology use. If we travel around the world, we'll see that there's a lot of manufacturing jobs that have gone to low-skilled workers all over the world. That's changing. In the age of robots, okay, the technology is changing. We're going to need a highly skilled labor force. The days of people, unskilled labor, working in manufacturing is coming to an end. This is the future. In order to be able to adapt to the new technologies that are coming, we need a highly skilled workforce. We need to invest in research and development to be leaders in this area. Right? It's a change that's coming, and we have to anticipate it. So basically, education, training, and also creating a climate where it's easy for manufacturers to be able to create jobs in Canada. So, thank you.
Thank you, Vince. Karina.
Thank you. This is a topic that is particularly close to my heart because my background is international trade. And I have worked with a number of manufacturers across this region and across this country who have talked about the fact that we don't have a partner in Ottawa when it comes to manufacturing, and we don't have a focus and a strategy and dedicated leadership to making sure that not only are we growing what we currently have, but we are strategically searching out opportunities to grow Canadian markets abroad with a clear focus. And one thing that I want to mention is that we have committed as the Liberal Party to invest in innovation, invest in research and technology, and to invest in clean technology. Because we already know that the clean tech sector employs more people in Canada than does the resource sector, but we need to have a clear and focused strategy to develop our strong industries and to make sure that we have a strong manufacturing base that's getting our goods to market.
Thank you, Karina. David.
Thank you. The NDP has a plan to invest in a multi-sectoral approach to develop our manufacturing sector. The highlight and flagship of this process is going to be developing clean, renewable, green energy for Canadian industry. The NDP plan is to be world leaders in this area. It's projected that this new economy moving forward will generate between $5 and $7 trillion in economic output. We have, despite the fact that some of our infrastructure is crumbling, we're also making major trade investments into infrastructure and transit to keep our economy up to speed, which will have spin-off effects in the industrial sector. But the main focus is on clean, renewable energy. We have the infrastructure, for example, in Burlington to be major leaders in this area. We're also looking at major investments in the aerospace industry to continue to pursue that neglected area of the Canadian economy with high-paying, high-tech, high-skilled jobs. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Mike.
Thank you for the question. Canada spends about $8 billion, the government spends $8 billion on innovation in a year. We had a look at it a number of years ago. Were we getting our bang for the buck? And the answer came back is that most of that money was going to tax credits for companies who are large enough to be able to have the time and effort to get those tax credits. But not enough money was being generated into direct innovation projects through a program, for example, for IRAP, the Industrial Research Assistance Program. So we have moved, we reduced the tax credit and we moved money over into IRAP to directly support manufacturers in the development of innovation, because that is the only way that they will survive. During this election period, and what had been working, the McMaster and the Brunswick Economic Organization had been working on bringing a manufacturing innovation hub to Burlington, and when the Prime Minister was in Burlington a number of weeks ago, he announced that if re-elected, we will have a manufacturing innovation hub right here in Burlington.
Thank you, Mike. Question number 10. And this one actually is directed specifically to Karina Gould. And again, the other candidates will be invited to respond. Canadian cities are under stress for transportation infrastructure. How does your party recognize this important issue, which affects our social and business lives? Karina?
Thank you for that great question. So, as I mentioned earlier, the Liberals have a plan to invest $125 billion over the next 10 years in infrastructure. $20 billion, and that's 20 new billion dollars, would go towards public infrastructure. Public transit infrastructure. And that is extremely important because I've heard from people at the chamber, I've heard from people at the door, and I've heard from people across the city that we need to be able to get where we need to go, when we need to get there. And so that means that we are going to work in partnership with municipalities, with provinces to develop public interest, to develop public transit. And my personal opinion is that we need to not only be able to get from Burlington or Appleby GO Station downtown Toronto, but we also need to be able to move around the region on good public transit and within Burlington. And so I am looking forward to working with the mayor and looking with our MPP to develop a solid transit plan for this community. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. David.
Thank you. There's twofold answer to this question on infrastructure and transit for the NDP. We're looking at dedicating 1 cent of the existing GAX tax directly to infrastructure programs in through provinces to municipalities. But we're also looking at $1.3 billion per year in dedicated funding to municipalities for their transit programs. As we well know, the transit's a necessary component for any kind of industrial country, and it's a necessary component for advanced trade and manufacturing. Public transit largely is used by people with low income or moderate means, and the costs have escalated to the point where a lot of people are having to choose between, you know, taking a bus ride to go to work or to the doctor or something to that effect, and having a meal or paying rent. So we're looking at reducing the cost of transit as well for everybody. But we'll have to, for example, in Burlington, work with our municipal leaders who don't seem too motivated in the public transit area.
Thank you, David. Mike.
How about you, Doug?
Thank you, Bruce. Let's look at the facts. In the 12 years that the Liberal government was here from, I think, before our government took over, those 12 years, they spent $3.4 billion on infrastructure. The 10 years that we've been in government, it's $12.4 billion. So about three times as much we've spent in the decade that we've been in government. We believe in infrastructure. We have a $53 billion plan for infrastructure over the next number of years. It doesn't require us to go into deficit to pay for it. And we believe that the decisions to be made on infrastructure, whether it's roads or transit, need to be made by those closest to it, either at the provincial level for GO Train or for local transit systems with municipalities. We're happy to be their partners on infrastructure, but we have a plan for that to happen.
Thank you, Mike. Vince.
Well, the fact is that our infrastructure has been kept up to high quality standards. We do have roads that are falling apart. We do have bridges that are falling apart. Our railways are not doing so well. We're moving more and more freight. As we produce more and more petrochemicals, we're moving more and more of it across our railway systems. And the Lac-Megantic tragedy is an example of when you don't have adequate infrastructure, of the types of disasters we can have. And by the way, those rail cars are moving through Burlington. So those types of disasters can't happen here. If we don't invest in our infrastructure and make it so it's good, high quality infrastructure, then we are risking the same types of tragedies here. So we believe that we need to improve our infrastructure, invest in it. That's an example of where government creating the proper policies is what creates the situation where private enterprise can create jobs. So we believe that creating opportunities for companies to be able to invest in, to basically take advantage of investments in infrastructure.
Thank you, Vince. Question number 11. Under anti-terror legislation, we have recently deported a born Canadian. My question is, do you think citizenship is a right or a privilege? We'll start this with David.
Well, I think this is in reference to people with dual citizens. I'll just cut to the chase on this. I think that, well, I know that citizenship is a right. This is a wedge issue, and there are long-term implications of pursuing this idea of being able to take away people's citizenships. And it has the potential to create second-class citizens, not just within the country, but globally as well. I think it's a responsibility of a country to take care of its own. If you give citizen to a person, just like if you adopt a child, you don't just change your mind because it's not working out and give them out. You work through the problems. If somebody's committing crimes within your country or threatening other countries through whatever acts, through terrorism,
then you have to deal with it internally. I certainly reject outright any idea of dual citizenship, or sorry, two-tiered citizenship and the ability to take away somebody's citizenship. Absolutely not.
Thank you, David. Mike.
Yeah, just to clarify the question, no one has been deported yet. They have to serve their time for the terrorist crime that they have been convicted of, which is a number of years. But under C-24, convicted terrorists, including those who open and declare war on Canada against Canadians, can travel around the world at present, or before the law became into being, and hide behind a Canadian passport. Convicted terrorists will be stripped of their citizenship if they have dual citizenship. Okay. I'm the only one at the table here at that the group of 18 were coming to Ottawa to kill me, to kill a number of Canadians, including us as parliamentarians.
It was actually
and so the fact of the matter is, we believe that if you're a dual citizenship and you are committing terrorist crimes against Canadians, it is a privilege to be a Canadian. And not a right.
Thank you, Mike. Wow. Vince?
If you're born in Canada, you're a Canadian citizen. Case closed. Now, there are people who have dual citizenship. My personal belief is, pick your loyalty. I don't think people should have dual citizenships. That's my own personal opinion. As far as terrorism is concerned, when somebody uses the term terrorism, it means one of two things to me. Either trying to manipulate me, or they've been manipulated themselves. What we're talking about here are crimes like murder. Okay, there's only really three ways of how you can kill somebody. Basically, you committed a crime, you're insane, or it's an act of war. So we don't need new laws to criminalize behaviors which are already illegal. The point of terrorism is to basically create fear and hate against certain groups of people. If the young man who killed three RCMP officers out in Nova Scotia, if he had said Allah first, he would have been a terrorist. But he didn't, so he's just a criminal. Then we had a crazy person who went on Parliament Hill trying to kill people, and he did say Allah first. So he is a terrorist. To put things in perspective, there's been far more people killed by moose in this country than have been killed by terrorists. And I think that we spend so much money on this, and really what it's about is about taking away rights and freedoms.
Thank you, Vince. Karina.
Thank you. This, like most of these questions, this requires a longer answer than 60 seconds, so I'm happy to speak with anyone about this afterwards. But there are two things that we need to be extremely concerned about in Bill C-24. The first one is the fact that in Canada, we have a separation of powers. We have a separation between legislators and the implementers of the law. What Bill C-24 does is it allows the legislator, the minister, to create the law and to implement it. That is an extraordinarily dangerous precedent that we should not be traveling down, and we all need to be aware of this to ensure that it does not happen in the future and that we repeal this part of the legislation. The second part is when we talk about a citizen. What we were talking about, what was in the news yesterday, is that there was a Canadian-born citizen who supposedly has dual citizenship. The only reason they say that is because his parents, when they immigrated to Canada, were from Pakistan. They gave up their citizenship when they became Canadian citizens, and now this individual who has no ties to that country, citizenship is being revoked. That is wrong, that is illegal,
thank
and
you,
is unconstitutional, and citizenship is a right, and we should be very, very committed
thank
to maintaining that.
So I have to be the meanie, I just gotta make sure
it's job.
Fair for everyone. That's my job, and I get paid nothing for it. Okay. My coffee's even cold. Anyway, question number 12. Recent years have seen individuals' retirement savings dwindle. What plan does your party have to improve the Canada pension plan and ensure that people can retire with an adequate income? And Mike, you're starting.
Thank you for the question. The CPP, which is has an agreement that all provinces have to agree to any changes to the CPP. You cannot do it unilaterally as a federal government. You just cannot do it. When Minister Flaherty approached the provinces a number of years ago about what they wanted to do, there were a couple of provinces that said, no, we're not interested in any changes. We are not actively pursuing any changes to CPP. Anybody who tells you about changes to CPP, I was at an event with Seniors Thinking they were thinking that if a change happened tomorrow for CPP, their revenue would go up that they would get. It's not going to happen. It's 15, 16, 17, maybe 20 years away before you saw any results for any change from CPP. We think it's the wrong time to be taking more money from employers and employees to be paying for change to CPP. There are we have worked on other options for retirement.
And thank you, Mike. Vince.
The Green Party has a plan to implement a national senior strategy. We believe in a housing plan with affordable, predictable home care support. So that people want to stay in their homes. If they have the health to be able to do it, they should be able to stay in their homes. We believe in a guaranteed living income where people can afford to live a life with dignity, no matter how old they are. PharmaCare plan. Basically, the government buys drugs in bulk and then passes the savings on to the consumers of that. And we believe that everybody should be entitled to health benefits and medication. Okay, we believe in a national dementia strategy, long-term care beds in neighborhood facilities so that people can visit their elderly. We believe that some of our communities maybe have to be redesigned to handle the number of dementia people that are coming. There's a big wave coming. We believe in a Canada pension plan that's been expanded. We believe in promotion of intergenerational daycare programs where seniors and young people can work to socialize together and pass on.
Thank you, Vince. Karina?
Just because something is difficult doesn't mean you shouldn't do it. We have committed to, within 3 months of forming government, doing one of these things at First Minister's meeting and meeting with the provinces to discuss Canada Pension Plan reform. Even if something is going to take 15 or 20 years to get done, my generation, a lot of people don't have pensions. So it's important that we start working on this now so that we can ensure a dignified retirement for future generations of Canadians as well. With regards to the immediate term, however, upon forming government, the Liberal Party would immediately increase the guaranteed income supplement by 10%, and we would create something called the Seniors Price Index, which would evaluate the cost of living based on the goods that seniors consume and index that new price to old age security and the guaranteed income supplement so that we can start working immediately for the needs of seniors today and also for seniors in the future.
Thank you, Karina. David?
Thank you. In addition to some of the initiatives I outlined earlier, including seniors initiatives for home care, health care, pharma care, the NDP is also committed to putting in $400 million immediately into the guaranteed income supplement to raise over 200,000 seniors out of poverty. But I just want to emphasize too here that, you know, we spoke earlier about 70% of the population wanting significant change, and up here I think that's naturally represented by three of the four candidates who are addressing a lot of the issues that are of concern to Canadians. But we have an electoral system that allows 30% of the population to represent the interests of 4% of the population. 96% of the population have seen no real significant economic benefit to this government in the last 10 years. That's one of the reasons that we're looking at bringing in multi-member proportional representation so that your government better reflects the wishes and needs of the population it serves.
Thank you.
Thank you, David. Entering question number 13. How would you balance the interests of Burlington when they are not on a par with your federal platform direction? Vince.
This is an easy one for the Green Party to answer. Green Party policy is that elected MPs represent their constituency first, Green Party policy second. Okay, now you're going to find that none of the other candidates actually have a plan for consulting Burlington citizens. So the only, it seems like every time there's an election, they want to listen to you. But as soon as they're elected, they're not listening to you unless you are a supporter of their party. I'm not like that. When I'm elected MP, my plan is to create citizen advisory committees, which I'm going to talk about in more detail in my closing arguments. But basically, I have a plan to consult you. And a plan that's going to make it so that the real decision-making power, when I become an elected MP, will be citizens in Burlington. The basic idea is that citizens of Burlington are going to tell me how to vote, and I'm going to vote accordingly, and I'll talk about how I'm going to do that in my closing arguments.
Thank you, Vince. Karina.
Thank you. The job of a member of parliament is to represent their constituents. That is who elects them, and that is who they are ultimately responsible to and accountable to. I believe in the Liberal Party platform. I believe that we are putting forward a plan that is good not just for the constituents, but for the country as a whole. However, if there was an occurrence where I felt that the party position was detrimental to my community, you can guarantee that I would not be supporting an initiative of such a manner, and that I would be actively engaged from the time I take office until I leave in consulting with the community, as I believe I've demonstrated over the past year, where I've held countless town halls and roundtables discussing issues of importance that have fed directly into the development of the policies of the Liberal platform. So that will continue when I become elected, and I look forward to working with all of you and listening and speaking up for you in Ottawa.
Thank you, Karina. David.
Well, as you all know, the NDP has worked extensively with the Federation of Canadian Municipalities to develop policies that meet the individual needs of various communities. The first thing that I'm gonna do to ensure that Burlington has a party that represents their interests is I'm going to vote David Laird on October 19th. And I do that consistently over the last four or five elections. But no, I mean, Karina outlined some very important points. There are going to be times when party policy may be in direct contradiction to the wishes of constituents. Not all constituents, obviously. There's a range of points of view and perspectives in any community. But I view it as my job as MP to manage these kinds of issues in a long-term sense throughout the political tenure of my career to make the best choice long-term for this community. There will be gives and takes along that time. That's politics. And I will work with the community in consultation to make sure the long-term needs of the community are met.
Thank you, David. Mike?
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you for the question. And I think if you check the Hansard and check the voting records of all the parties, you will find that actual fact, the Conservative Party members have voted against their government on private members' bills more often than any other party in the House of Commons. I myself have voted twice against the direction on private members' bills on two items. The way it works in Ottawa, and I think appropriately so, is that you are part of a team. You're part of the Liberal team, the NDP team, and the Conservative team. And as a caucus, you meet on Wednesday mornings, and you have an opportunity to say your piece. There has been one issue that we voted on that I was not happy with. I voted with the team. I got up in caucus and said, I'm not voting that way ever again. Unfortunately, that issue has taken care of itself, never coming back. But there are opportunities to say your piece, to represent your constituents, and I think I've done a very good job of doing that. Thank you.
Thank you. So I see that we have time for one more question. I do apologize we can't get to all the questions submitted. We've tried to capture as much of the sentiment and consensus within the submissions. Question number 14, efficient transportation is important to Burlington businesses. With the CN hub coming to the Halton region, it is expected that truck traffic on our highways will increase. How do you plan to assist our city with this? And Karina, you'll lead off.
Thank you very much for that question. I remember at the Chamber of Commerce meeting when Mr. Trudeau was here back in April that transportation was a big issue, and it was something that we've discussed at length. I think one of the issues that we need to talk about is we need to discuss a transportation vision and plan for the region. The QEW, the 403, these are some of the heaviest truck traffic areas in North America. And we need to work together, we need to work with business, we need to work with residents, and we need to work with the community to develop that plan moving forward to figure out what it is that we do to mitigate that traffic, but what also the strategies are to improve the transportation so that
businesses can get their goods where they need to go when they need to be there. The other issue that we discussed was border and border management, and that's something that's going to require dedicated leadership at the federal level to work with our American partners to make sure that our goods are not being held up at the border. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. David?
Thank you. I already spoke earlier about the $1.5 billion in increased infrastructure spending that the NDP is proposing. And that's up to provinces and municipalities to decide how that money is best to be spent. But as somebody who spends between an hour, 3 hours and 4 hours a day sitting on the QEW, recognizing that the center lane from here to eastern Toronto is all trucks, I think that there's some important initiatives that we all need to consider, is putting some of that truck traffic back on rails. And the only way we're going to do that is by reducing rail rates so that it's more economical for manufacturers to use the rail industry. As you know, the infrastructure for rail as well has been degraded over the years, and we've witnessed that with some tragic accidents. Conservatives have gone ahead and left stewardship over that program to the rail industry. The NDP has initiatives to make sure that the rail industry is regulated and safe for Canadians.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Mike.
Thank you for the question. And the CN intermodal issue is going to be one. Once there's an environmental assessment that's going on right now, once its results, it will tell us what the environmental impacts will be, and which will include the transportation impacts. I see for the federal government to be a partner with the region of Halton and the city of Milton and probably the province of Ontario, at looking how improvements to the infrastructure in terms of the road system that we have around here, there may be some improvements in terms of changes to the connections to the 403 and so on, to be able to move that traffic out of this area. I'm not personally in favor of a new road through the escarpment that was thought of as some way of connecting to the border to the Niagara region here through the Niagara escarpment. I think we have the road structure here. If we improve on it, improve on that infrastructure, hopefully, if that is approved, that intermodal is approved, we'll handle that traffic.
Thank you, Mike. Vince.
Green Party policy is a national transportation strategy which emphasizes more efficient moving of people through the infrastructure, better rail system as much as possible, but also trying to get people out of their cars as much as possible. And in order to be able to do that, you need better public transit. So we believe in smart development, urban infrastructure being more intensified, and protecting our natural areas. Basically, the better the public transit is, the fewer people will be commuting to work by their cars, it'll reduce the amount of traffic on it, and be able to make it so that we can actually move more goods and services through our roads when there's fewer people driving by themselves on a car. So we're talking about building better infrastructure, controlling where facilities like this CN hub is being built should be built in an area where it creates transportation problems. All right, we do have transportation hubs that exist already on the off ramps of every single major highway, as well as along the railway corridor.
Thank you, Vince, and thank you, candidates. You will now have 90 seconds for your closing remarks, and we're going to go in reverse order to the opening remarks. So Karina, you can lead us.
Great.
Karina Gould.
Thank you. It's okay, thank you, Bruce. I don't mind being called Karina. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here today, and I thank everyone for the excellent questions and the chance to discuss my policies, but also my party's policies, and to contrast those with the other policies of the different parties. So growing up in Burlington and working at my family business, I understand how important small businesses contribute not just to our economy, but also to our community. But I also understand that none of these businesses would be possible without opportunity, without the promise of a fair, equitable country where we work together to succeed. The Harper government only works with Canadians when it's convenient for them, which is usually just before an election. A Liberal government would change that. That's why Liberals have assembled a strong team and a strong plan that will grow the economy, create jobs, and strengthen the middle class. We need to decide where we want Canada to be in the future and how we are going to get there. I have demonstrated through my work in the community that as your Liberal Member of Parliament, I will work with everyone in Burlington. I will work with you every single day I'm in office, and I will be your voice in Ottawa, and I will be focused on what matters to you. As was mentioned, my name is Karina Gould. I'm your Liberal candidate here in Burlington. And on October 19th, let's come together to change the country for the better. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Karina. Mike Wallace.
Thank you, Bruce. And I again want to thank the sponsors of today's event, the Chamber and Kojo for covering this this discussion. Voting patterns, people will tell us, and the political science will tell us, are based basically on three items. One, your local leadership, and I would hope that if you look at my record in the last 10 years here as your MP, that you look favorably on the work that I've done for this community and my connections with this community, and I would like to be able to continue that effort. Two, party policy. If you look at the party policy that we have brought forward for this election and our record of success that we have had over the last 10 years in leading us through the worst recession since the Depression. If you look at the party policy for small business, whether it's reducing from 11 to 9% the small business tax rate, the manufacturing hub that we're bringing here, the reduction in the EI requirements in terms of down to $1.49 from per 100 for every individual and business, we have a plan that's affordable and balanced. And finally, you have to look, people vote on leader of the party, leader of the country. And if you look at the competency of who is running for those positions, in my view, Stephen Harper is by far the most competent to be the Prime Minister of Canada. On October 19th, vote Mike Wallace.
Thank you, Mike. Vince Fiorito.
So first I'd like to thank the Burlington Chamber of Commerce for allowing me to talk at this debate. So cut to the chase. In this election, I think you fundamentally have two choices, old style politics or the new. If either of my candidates on my left here are elected, they're not gonna really represent you or even their party. They're gonna represent their leaders. And Mike Wallace is quite correct. The Conservatives are the ones that step to the line the most often, with the NDP being the most whipped group of MPs in the House. Justin Trudeau says he's going to use the whip sparingly. Well, if you look at how he's interfered in the candidate selection process, I don't think that's going to be true. Okay? Now, when Mike Wallace and the Harper Conservatives swept in power, they promised a new era of transparency, accountability, and integrity, but they haven't. Okay, we know that Nigel Wright gave Mike Duffy a large check, and Mr. Harper says that he didn't know anything about it. Well, either he's compromised his integrity, or his closest advisors weren't being transparent. Either way, the caucus closed ranks around him, and what does that tell you about accountability? The root problems aren't our political leaders. The problem is that power is concentrated in the hands of too few people. Green Party policy requires that we represent our constituency first, Green Party policy second. If you elect me, I'm going to create citizen advisory committees, one per ministerial portfolio, six people per panel, and there'll be 234 people that'll be elected. And those people will be honest, reliable, trustworthy, hardworking, and they're going to basically argue the points amongst themselves, and however they decide that they want me to vote,
thank
that's
you,
what
Vince.
I'm going to vote.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you again to the Chamber for hosting this event. Thank you all for attending. I just want to say that I was really surprised at the range of questions that we received here today. I was all prepared with complex tax questions and deficit questions and all that kind of thing. And the questions that came out were largely social and personal and intimate, and it's a reflection of the changing wishes of the electorate, and it's something that's not reflected in the conversation that we've been hearing through this last election. But having said that, again, I just want to say thank you for that. It's a very warm discussion I found here. As I said, this is my fifth time running, and for those of you who followed me, I predicted the failures of this current government and their economic policies. They've been largely discredited internationally. And the reality, the international community is moving to the left. They're moving back to policies of investment in communities and people, and we need to lead that charge. I understand monetary policy, international trade policy, international politics, and the complex issues that we face as a country in that community.
But I've also spent 25 years working at the grassroots in communities where the police don't go, the ambulances don't go, and the fire departments don't go. I understand the complex network of issues that people face, raising children, people with mental health disabilities. I understand these issues, and I think I'm the candidate that can bring those together with practical policies and work with the community to bring effective change for the country and for our community. Thank you.
Thank you, David. And a sincere thank you on behalf of the Chamber to all of our candidates for participating today, and more so for demonstrating their interest in representing their community. I mean, it takes a lot of commitment to take that time and energy to run for a political position, and we must be thankful for that. So a round of applause for all of our candidates. I'm sure our audience found this meeting meaningful and enlightening, because I know I did, and I want to thank our audience for their questions and for being well behaved, so thank you. I knew you could be. I want to also thank, I've been waiting to say this, Timer Tammer. And once again, thank you to the Realtors Association of Hamilton Burlington for sponsoring this event. Quick commercials, upcoming chamber events. October 7th, we have the Distinguished Entrepreneur Dinner at the Convention Center. October 20th, we have the President Steve Steos of the Hamilton Bulldogs, the newest entry in the OHL, to speak at the Art Gallery of Burlington. We have an economic forecast plan for November 3rd. Featuring the chief economist from Scotiabank and the managing editor of Canadian Business and Money Sense magazine. And if that rings a bell, our mayor has been mentioning how Money Sense magazine has named us the top city in our category to live in Canada. And we also have our mayor's luncheon event on December 3rd, featuring Louise St-Pierre of Cogeco, the president and CEO, and thank you, Cogeco, for taping this today, and we look forward to seeing your president and CEO. So once again, thank you so much for attending. Thank you, candidates, so much for your involvement, and I wish you all a good day, but remember, get out and vote on the 19th. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll see you guys.
Good to see you again.
Oh, nice to meet you.
What is that?